The ideas expressed in the following presentations are those of the speakers and do not necessarily reflect the views of ACI or its committees. ACI web sessions are recorded at ACI conventions or other concrete industry events and will be made available for viewing free of charge for 1 week. Thereafter, they will be archived on the ACI website or added to ACI's online CEU program, depending on their content.
I'm glad you're here with me today, and I'm going to be talking about some really cool, really, really fun research that we've been doing at Oklahoma State University. And this has been the work of my PhD student, Dan Cook, and he is here in the audience today. And I'm looking forward to the great contributions he's going to make to concrete in the future. I want to also thank the folks that helped fund this research. I could not have done this work without them. And here's the outline of my talk. I'm going to talk a bit about packing models, something called the box test, something called the tarantula curve, and then some conclusions. So why are we here today? What's it all about? We want to know how to proportion aggregates. We want to decide how to make good concrete, right? And we want to know, are these packing models everyone's talking about, are they useful? And is one better than another? And do they provide practical answers? These are all things I think, at least if I was sitting where you were, I would have in my mind that I would want to have try to be answered. And packing, what is it all about? Well, the idea is you jam in all these rocks, right, and you try to minimize the amount of voids inside your concrete. That's the concept. Okay, and the paste acts as like, they call it like grease in a ball bearing, is what this quote says. Okay, it's that provides the workability aspects of what's going on. It helps to bind the aggregates together once the paste hardens. There's more to it than that, though. Reducing the voids in aggregates is obviously a good thing. I think if we can reduce paste, that's obviously a good thing as well. But we need to have a mixture that's workable. And hopefully in our minds, we can all imagine this concept that you drive this paste down further and further and further. And you drive the rock so close together that it's not workable anymore, right? We need to avoid that, okay? And we're going to be talking about packing models. We're going to be talking about the modified Topher method, just a little bit, daily rod method, specific surface area, combined dry rotted unit weight. Those are all methods. And then we're going to talk about graphical tools as well. Some might call these proportioning methods, the coarseness factor, the power 45, the percent retainer. We're going to kind of run all these together, see how they all compare to one another. And we're going to be talking about pavements, concrete slip form pavements. That's what it's all about today, okay? We have aggregate, we have concrete that looks like this, coming out the placed in front, and in back, it looks like that. Now on a pavement, workability is important, but you have a window of workability. You have an area where you need your concrete to be workable enough that when you hit it with a vibrator, you can consolidate it. But not too workable, because if it's too workable, you'll actually have edge slumping. Right? You don't want that. It's not what you want. Right? So we have this window right now that we're after. And if you look at the paver, if you look at what's responsible for consolidating, what's responsible for doing the most work, it's the vibrator. It's all about the vibrator. Okay, so what we really need is we need to understand, how does concrete respond to vibration, and yet, can it still hold an edge? So we try to come up with a test that's simple. Now, I'm a very simple person, right? I like simple things in life, especially when they work, right? But I'm looking for a test that can measure the response to vibration of the concrete, measure this filling ability of the grout, the ability to fill these holes, right? So we don't have voids inside our concrete. And again, it has to hold an edge. Has to be cohesive, has to hold things together. And I'm going to be talking about the box test. Okay, the box test is pretty simple. It's a box. 12 inches by 12 inches by 12 inches. Open top and open bottom. Okay, it's actually two L's that are held together by these really, really expensive pipe clamps. $20, loads. You need two of them. Okay, that's what you need. We're going to take 9.5 inches of unconsolidated concrete. We're going to put inside the box. We're going to take a 1-inch diameter stinger vibrator. We're like, whoa, that's not a paver vibrator. No, it's not. It's not. It's a stinger vibrator. We've sized the vibrator, the RPMs, and the energy to match the amount of energy that a paver would typically put in the concrete with a typical vibrator spacing at a typical speed. So that's really important. So you go 3 seconds into the concrete, 3 seconds out, in the very, very, very center. Wow, it's just flipping on me here. The edges of the box are then removed and inspected for honeycombing or edge slumping. These are all words. I'm a graphical person. I don't know about you. Let's watch this task being run. So there we go. We got our 9.5 inches unconsolidated concrete. Got the vibrator going above. Bring the vibrator down 3 seconds, and we can see with our own eyes the sphere of influence of the vibrator. Look, it's about here. It's not quite where we want it to be. We want it to be at the edge. When we pull the vibrator out and we drop the edges of the forms, we'll see. I hope you can see it. I can see it up here pretty well. You might not be able to. There's honeycombing on the sides. This is not what we want. Okay? It means it didn't respond well to the vibration. Let's look at a mix it did. Okay? Vibrator's going in. Wow. Look at that sphere of influence. Look how you've changed the surface. When you vibrated the concrete, you removed the voids along the walls. So when you take the edges off, it looks like a perfect concrete brownie. Mmm, brownie, right? You guys can't laugh. That's allowed, okay? But the best concretes, the best one of them, have to surpass this next test. That's me standing with 1 foot on top of the concrete brownie 30 minutes after it's been placed. No, that's not part of the test method, okay? But that's 30-minute-old concrete holding me on top of. That's how much packing we've gotten, you know, inside there. That's pretty impressive. And it's still not edge slumping. And look, we can look and inspect these voids. See that? Now, the way we rate mixes is we use a graphical technique or an observational technique like this. We go around and we say, ha, how many voids do I have? This is obviously not good. This is better. This is where we'd be okay with, and this would be awesome. And we're okay with a visual ranking of a 2 or a 3 in our box test. If we get a 3 or a 4, we're not happy. We would say it failed. We also can look at edge slumping. We use a straight edge, okay? Can measure if it's edge slumped more than, you know, a quarter of an inch. That's failure. That's not good. We have no edge slumping on the left, edge slumping on the right. You can see it with your own eyes, okay? It does happen. Remember, why do we do this? Because we want a window of workability. It needs to respond to the vibration, but not be so workable that it edge slumps and falls down. So the way to evaluate a mixture, this is the real power of this test, is that I can make a concrete mixture. We can run slump and the box test. And we can ask, did it pass? And if the answer is no, you throw everything back into the mixer. You add a known amount of water reducer, mix everything back up again, and run the test again. And you may follow this loop on the bottom left hand over and over again until it does. And once it does, you'd say, okay, I'm done. And you record the amount of water reducer. Mixtures that take lots of water reducer are not useful to us. They're not helpful. Mixtures that require less water reducer, those are the ones we want. That's what we're after. Does that make sense, everybody? Great. So what's it about? The box test evaluates the response of a concrete mixture to vibration and the ability to hold an edge. We did this because no other test exists. The slump test tells you nothing about how a concrete will pave. It's a great consistency test, but it doesn't tell you how it's going to pave. Okay? Low amounts of water reducer is good. High amounts are bad. Great. So, single operator variation in this test, this is all published. I'm happy to give you the references. Plus or minus 1.5 ounces per hundredweight. Multiple operators, about 3.2. We did multiple small dosages versus one large dose with the water reducer. We didn't see, you know, any differences. And if the sample doesn't pass the box test within an hour, we throw it away. And the box test has compared very, very well with paving mixes. And we'll talk more about that coming up. So let's evaluate. Let's use this test to evaluate all these different packing concepts. We're going to use a 0.45 water to cement ratio, 5 sacks total cementitious material. We're going to use a single sand source and 3 different aggregates. Okay? Now, I'm going to graphically show you where our mixtures are going to end up. Okay? We're going to have some mixtures with every one of these aggregates. We're going to put one dead center in the coarseness factor. Dead bottom. 60-40, 60% coarse, 40% fine. We're going to have this minimum voids from the modified Topher, and then a tight fit on the Power 45. We're going to compare how they all do. Okay, that's what this next chart does. So we've got different locations on the different gradation packing concepts down here on the x-axis. We have dosage in the box test on the y-axis. And we say I've segregated these into three different categories. We have the yes, we have the no, and then we have the no way, or add in your own term there, right? And we would like to be down here. We'd like to have this be as low as we possibly can. And we say, what do we notice from this? What do we see? That sometimes mixtures are ending up down here in the bottom in the yes. Sometimes they are. But in the exact same spot in the coarseness factor, we have one that's doing horrible. Same way here on the bottom. We have one doing great and one doing horrible. 60, 40, none of them are doing great. Power 45. Anyway, it's the same trend. There's no trend. Okay? Let's look at the coarseness factor data. Now, I've plotted all these points on this chart and put the water reducer dosage for each one. And the most striking things we could see from this is that all of these plots, all these points, are in the dead center of the coarseness factor chart. And look at the variance in dosages required to pass the box test. They're all over the place. Same thing in the bottom. I have some that are outside that are doing well. Some that are way over here that are doing well. This suggests that it doesn't correspond with this box test, this data. So let's look at dry-rotted unit weight. A lot of people think this. Let's throw all the rock and all the sand in, do a dry-rotted unit weight on it, and let's see what happens. Okay? And we're showing voids content down here on the x-axis, showing water reducer dosage again on the y-axis, and we get, have our friends again, the yes, the no, and the no way. And what do we see here? There's not much correspondence. So what's going on? It's not helpful. Let's look at this modified Topher. We see the same type of trend. It's not helpful, at least to predict workability in the box test. Let's look at Deleron. Same thing. Not helpful for performance in the box test. We have just as many doing bad as we do good at similar voids contents. Let's look at specific surface area. Again, we see the same concept, okay? So, in summary, none of the following showed good results. The voids content for the two packing models, the specific surface area, the voids content in the combined dry-rotted unit weight, or the location in the coarseness factor chart. None of them helped us. So let's look at the percent retained. We have our friends the no way, okay? They don't look very good. We have our friends the no, and then we have our friends the yes. You better pay attention to this. This is big time. All the yes, all the good performing mixtures were within the haystack curve, or within the 818. This is useful. This is the only thing that's worked so far. So the percent retained chart did a good job of indicating which gradation would have a good performance in the box test. But how about the power 45 curve? People love that. So let's look at our no's. Okay, and then let's look at our yeses. But then let's compare a few net yeses to a few no's. Now, I don't know about you, but I can't really tell much of a difference between the yeses and the no's. They look kind of similar. Sure, there's a little out here and a little out there, but you can't tell much difference. But if you go to the percent retained, it's very easy to tell a difference. So while I think the Power 45 or some packing model may be useful, it's tough on that scale to really see differences. And this much better teases out what's important and what's not. So to look at this even more, we took those three aggregates I told you about, and we sieved them so the gradation was exactly the same. Exactly the same in all three. So you think they might perform the same. They don't. They're different. So you start to look at why. Why would they be different? And Eric brought it up earlier. He said it. You have to look at the aggregates. You have to look at the shape. And if we line these up in terms of the lowest amount of water reducer required to pass the test to the highest amount, they match directly with the flatness and elongation of the particle. The particles that were cubic shape didn't require any. The particles that were flat and elongated required much more. So grading isn't everything. But it's a great step to get you in the right ballpark. with your aggregate that you're dealing with. And flatness is really important. So while the individual percent retained chart did the best job of the techniques, the aggregate flatness and texture still plays a role, okay? So we've kind of built something cool. We've built this kind of Porsche that can evaluate concrete mixtures, right? Can give us some idea and insight. So let's go after it. Is the 818 curve the best? Is there something better out there? So we're going to use 0.45 water cement ratio, 20% fly ash, 3 different sand sources, 5 different coarse aggregates. This is real. This is big time, ladies and gentlemen. 4.5 sacks of total cementitious material. That's a very, very low paste content. Okay, let's go after it. And we can do all kinds of cool stuff. We can teeter the intermediate to the coarse. Okay, we can change the fine. We can teeter it around. Man, we have learned a ton of stuff that I don't have time to explain to you today. Okay. But we can but all of it's published, though. We can all talk about it. We've come up with something that when you could take all of our recommendations together, we call it the tarantula curve. Now, why is it a tarantula curve? Well, they used to call it the haystack curve because it looked like a haystack. Now it looks like spider, right? Looks like a big spider, right? You don't see it, huh? There's the head of the spider. There's the body of the spider. And I've drawn one right up there just so you can see it. Told you, spider. And every one of these limits, we actually tell you why it was established, why it was set, okay? And this is really important. This is number 8 and number 16 save size. Okay, if you get too much of it, you get horrible finishing problems. You run the trowel over the surface of your concrete, you actually pop stuff up. You have to pass it over 10 times sometimes to get it flat enough, okay? If you keep it below 12%, things are going to be good. If you ever jumped above 20%, we found in any one sieve size, that's one-fifth of your aggregate gradation being above any one sieve size just destroyed the performance of the mix almost off a cliff. Okay? This is also important. We found sands perform very differently from one another. We had a coarse sand and a fine sand. We have limitations on those. Okay? So, flatness and elongation. We found this 4791 test. This is a test where you take an aggregate and you compare the long dimension to the short dimension. Does a pretty good job of evaluating flatness. Okay? We compared a bunch of different aggregates and we found that these recommendations, these tarantula curve recommendations, worked for all of them, worked for 13 different aggregates except for 2 that didn't meet this flatness and elongation spec. And it was highly tied to how they're crushing the rock. And they know about this, but there's no spec to make them change. They don't. Just keep doing it that way. So we have 5 different concrete producers have actually tried this, and I actually hear more and more, you know, all the time. They've all seen improvements. There's 10 miles of CRCP in Texas that's been used with this mixture, and they saw great performance. The contractor claims that they saw 10% cost savings with a 25% reduction in the carbon footprint. 10% cost savings. And that's what they're telling people. You know how much money they really must have saved? Oh. Anyway, last thing I'm going to talk about. We have over a decade of mixtures from Minnesota DOT, okay? And we started to compare their mixtures to the actual tarantula curve. And we found in the early days, it looked like this. It was the Wild West of optimized graded concrete. And they had interesting performance in the field, from what I was told. But after a decade, after 10 years, 87% of them met the criteria. And after a couple more years, 98% of the mixtures met the criteria of the tarantula curve. This is why this is important. The tarantula curve hadn't even been invented yet when they were doing this. The contractors on their own were iterating to find what mixtures worked best. When you plotted all of them, that's where they fall. They fall within the same limits that we're suggesting people use. So over time, the contractors have iterated on their concrete pavement mixtures to improve them. They're doing this with trial and error and no knowledge of the actual tarantula curve. The large majority of their mixtures are fitting with the curve. That's pretty cool. And in conclusion, a single location or region on the coarseness factor chart, minimum voids content, or specific surface area does not predict the workability of a mixture with the box test and with these materials. The voids content and specific surface area may still be important. I think they are important. And I think what Eric talked about, I think you want to be near the top, but not necessarily at the top. But once you get up there, there's other things going on. The individual percent retained chart was a useful tool to evaluate mixtures. Shape and texture is important. Tarantula curve seems to be a useful technique. And the recommendations of the tarantula curve meet the field performance of the Minnesota pavement mixtures. All of this is on this website, optimizegraded.com. Specifications on there, papers are on there, Excel sheets on there. That's my website, tylerlay.com. And that's a concrete R2-D2. May the force be with you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.